WCVB-TV, Boston.
Tonight, nuclear weapons and what to do about them. We're coming to you live from the campus of Harvard University. Joining us, an audience of Harvard students and faculty and other concerned citizens. Our worldwide forum will include, via satellite from Moscow, Gennady Gerasimov. From London, Monsignor Bruce Kent. From Munich, Franz Josef Strauss. Joining me here in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Dr. Herman Kahn. In Chicago, Dr. Roger Molander. In Washington, Richard Burt. And in New York, McGeorge Bundy and Dr. Henry Kissinger.
This is ABC News Nightline, a special expanded edition reporting live from the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. Ted Koppel.
Good evening. This is our arena where we will shortly embark upon what the diplomats call an exchange of ideas. These men and women are concerned citizens of the Boston area, many of them students and faculty members from Harvard University. If there is one process that we have raised to a fine art in these United States, it is the process of reducing momentous issues to the level of manageable and, above all, catchy slogans and code words. Window of vulnerability. Don't try to understand it. Just be suitably worried about getting caught in its draft. Nuclear freeze. Why struggle with the complexity of arms reduction talks? Just do it and hope that they'll do it too. Even Dr. Roger Molander, whose Ground Zero Week, now underway, is intended to raise the consciousness and understanding of Americans about nuclear war, even Dr. Molander packaged the lesson in a slick paperback replete with catchy chapter headings like "The Bomb That's Coming to Dinner," "More Than You'll Ever Want to Know," "The Consequences of Nuclear War," and the snappy closing section, "You Ain't Heard Nothing Yet." But perhaps Dr. Molander and his colleagues are right. You've got to get people into the tent. And that's what Ground Zero Week has been doing, all over the country, all week long, including today.
One, two, three.
Peace!
It begins here. Everything begins at a small, local beginning.
Proud old heroes of a forgotten war, and the young people ask, what are they marching for? And I ask myself the same question. And the band plays waltz until fall, and the old men still answer the call. Year after year, their numbers grow few.
So we're gathered here to run, proposing that Americans discuss and debate this issue in a free and open society, that men will beat their swords into plowshares, and the lion will lay down with a lamb, and we will not study war no more.
The bomb is imminent!
In fairness to Dr. Molander, who is with us live from Chicago, this program tonight is the direct result of his campaign. There is no greater moral imperative in the world today than the management of nuclear weapons in an atmosphere of genuine understanding. Let's try to take a small step in that direction by meeting each of our guests. Dr. Molander, how do you avoid something like this being taken over just by the sloganeers? How do you avoid taking one of the most agonizing and complex issues of our time and having it reduced to meaninglessness?
Well, by having people like yourself involved in organizations like the church community in this country, the educational community, and really just having people express their faith in democracy, that citizens can get involved in even an issue like this.
All right, let's give you now a quote from our next guest. The Soviet Union must never be allowed to assume that there is any level of conflict at which it could conclude hostilities victoriously. Those are the words of Richard Burt, a former New York Times correspondent who is the director of the State Department's Bureau of Political Military Affairs. Mr. Burt is with us now from the Department of State in Washington. Mr. Burt, the other side of that question, how does the administration pass on to a democratic community like this one the message that will be sufficient to the needs of the government?
Ted, I don't think it's too terribly difficult to pass on that message. I don't see any real inconsistency between our policy, one of deterrence, which has been the policy of every administration since the post-war period, and a policy of pursuing real arms control, which has certainly been the policy of every administration, and the policy of democracy. In fact, I was just listening to Roger Molander a few seconds ago. I remember about 20 months ago when I was not a government official, I was a newspaper man, and Roger Molander was a government official. I think the fact that we have a free and open society that allows us to exchange ideas and debate these issues openly can only be a healthy sign.
From Washington to Moscow, joining us now via satellite from Moscow, Gennady Gerasimov, political observer for the Soviet news agency Novosti. Mr. Gerasimov, one has to ask, I suppose, could this kind of thing happen in the Soviet Union? And are we, do you think, at a disadvantage because our leaders have to convince a population to go along where yours presumably do not?
We do have our discussions on war and peace issues.
That's it? Would you like to say anything more?
Repeat your question, please, because I have a feedback, unfortunately.
I'm sorry. I wondered whether you had anything more to say on that subject. You say you have your discussions. One gets the impression in this country that they are not quite as far-reaching, perhaps, as they are in the United States.
Well, we have our discussions on war and peace issues almost every day. We have our articles. I have my booklets here, which I've written about it. And we have our quarrels with you. For instance, Robert Byrd said that arms control was the policy of every administration. I cannot really buy this because from my point of view, the Soviet side always wanted arms control and arms reductions, and there was never an initiator of new weapon systems.
All right, you and Mr. Byrd will have an opportunity to debate that issue a little bit later on. Now, another quote. An all-or-nothing military policy will play into the hands of the Soviet strategy of ambiguity, which seeks to upset the strategic balance by small degrees. The words are Henry Kissinger's from his book, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, first published in 1957. Dr. Kissinger is with us now in our New York studios. Since you wrote those words almost, 25 years ago, you think anything has seriously changed?
I think the reliance on nuclear weapons and the attempt by the West to substitute technology for effort has led to a situation in which now we are in danger of paralyzing ourselves with respect to the principal means of defense that we have built up, and in which we are in danger of losing side of the fact that we must maintain both peace and freedom, and that we have a problem of security, so that unless we balance our control of nuclear arms with a buildup of conventional weapons, we will be in a grave military danger, and we will not achieve the objective of peace with justice and freedom.
With us now via satellite from our London bureau, Monsignor Bruce Kent, Secretary General of Britain's Committee for Nuclear Disarmament. Monsignor Kent, one sometimes gets the impression when talking about nuclear freeze or disarmament that we are talking only to the West, only to the democracies, and that the influence of groups like your own is far greater here in the West than it is on the other side of the Iron Curtain. How would you respond?
I just don't think it's true. Whenever we've spoken, we've always spoken about the weapon systems on both sides. Our demonstration last October talked about the SS-20s. Our message is really quite simple, that both sides in this insane arms race have got far more weapons than they conceivably need for any kind of rational deterrence. So we are certainly, I think, even-handed.
And another quote from a guest overseas. Whoever diminishes the risks for the Soviet Union increases the danger of war. Those words were spoken by Franz Josef Strauss, former West German defense minister, head of the Bavarian wing of the Christian Democrat Party and one of West Germany's best-known conservative political leaders. Mr. Strauss is with us now via satellite from Munich. Do you get the sense, Mr. Strauss, particularly in Germany now, but I suppose the question ought to be addressed to you about all of Europe, that there is a drifting away from the great alliance with the United States of America and a move toward neutralism?
I don't think so, because all opinion polls indicate that a clear majority of about three quarters of the German population are undoubtedly for the alliance with the United States of America, including a common defense system with conventional and nuclear elements. We have had this debate on nuclear weapons since 1956, because we have always been within the range of Soviet weapons, a feeling which is rather new for our American friends. Therefore, as Minister of Defense and later on as a leader in Parliament, I have never made a secret of my heart that I think a flawless defense system, including a strong conventional element, but also nuclear weapons, are indispensable for maintaining peace and freedom. I want to accentuate peace and freedom. We have peace now in Poland, for instance, but no freedom. Peace without freedom is a kind of living condition which is unacceptable. But on the contrary, freedom without peace means to live in a permanent condition of being afraid of a catastrophe. So I would like to express my conviction. The fact that we have had now for 36 years no military shooting in Europe, first time in European history, is a consequence of the fact that war is no longer a political instrument in Europe where nuclear potentials are confronted with each other. There has been shooting in the last decades after World War II in Africa, in Near East, in Middle East, in Far East, in Latin America, but definitely not in Europe. Therefore, despite of the nuclear weapons we are confronted with, despite of the, let me say, dreadful auspices of nuclear war, we feel to be secure. We think that war is practically impossible in Europe.
All right, Mr. Strauss, so, forgive me for interrupting you. I want everyone to have an opportunity to speak now. We will be coming back to you a little later. Thank you. McGeorge Bundy, former national security advisor to President Kennedy, is co-author of an article in the latest issue of the magazine Foreign Affairs. He suggests in that article that the United States should disavow any intention of ever being the first to launch a nuclear first strike. Mr. Bundy is with us in our New York studios. Mr. Bundy, it seems like gratuitously giving away a strategic weapon, a card. Why not allow the ambiguity to exist?
Well, I believe that the ambiguity is doing us more harm than good at this stage. It is one of the reasons, I think, for the excessive reliance on nuclear weapons to which Dr. Kissinger has already referred. It gets in the way of the kind of restoration of a proper conventional balance, which I think many of us in this program would advocate. And in short, it is time, I think, to consider ways and means of moving from this position which has lasted so long.
And a final quote. Since we wish to be able to limit Soviet behavior to deter them from acts which cannot be met by limited means, we must have a credible first strike capability. The writer, Herman Kahn, the book on thermonuclear war. Mr. Kahn is with us now here at Harvard. Dr. Kahn, would you still hold to that view?
I think the exact quote was not incredible, and there's a distinct difference. You really can't achieve a capability which looks like it will be used, but you can achieve a capability which the other side cannot feel will not be used if he's too provocative. And that term, not incredible, is really carries an extraordinary amount of weight.
There is a potential on this program tonight for us to drown in double negatives. I wonder if you could put that into a straightforward sentence, Professor.
Absolutely not.
All right.
And let me spend a minute on that. The attempt to put these in straightforward sentences simply confuses. Take the concept of not probable. No, not probable is, say, less than 0.5. Improbable is less than 0.1. They are not, therefore, not improbable is quite different from probable. It's called a litote, and it's a perfectly legitimate grammatical construction.
I am sure that if anyone can teach it to me before this evening is over, you will be the man. During the rest of tonight's broadcast, we'll be joined in our discussion by members of our audience here at Harvard University, students, faculty, concerned citizens whom we have encouraged to pose questions of their own to our guests. Also, during the course of this broadcast, we will be presenting a number of taped comments on the subject of living in the nuclear age. Many, but not all of the comments come from well-known world figures. Some are noteworthy for their insight. Some are noteworthy simply because they make good sense.
I think it's sort of scary to think about nuclear war.
If we learned more about it and took kind of classes or things like that, then if we were prepared, I think we could probably get through one.
If they drop a missile, it don't only kill the bad people, it kills innocent ones.
Well, if I knew where it was gonna be, I would just get away from that place.
If we bomb other places, and by mistake we bomb other places that we think bombed us, we might get the whole world to blow up.
I think it's silly because it just can kill people, and that's no way to solve a problem. I think they should just talk.
If the leaders want to have a war, why don't they go someplace else and fight the war by themselves instead of killing other people over a silly argument?
I think it's scary because a lot of people would be killed, probably me too.
Make it comfortable. Good.
That was comfortable.
I've been giving my daughter tips on driving, and here's another important one. If you drive a car, you need premium performance tires. So I put Bridgestone Superfiller radios on Leslie's car. The hard rubber superfiller here lets the sidewall flex, so you get a big footprint of rubber for cornering, braking, handling, and comfort, too.
They're comfortable, Pop, and they're performers.
That's right. You can feel it when you drive. Bridgestone Superfiller steel-belted radials. See the yellow pages for a Bridgestone dealer near you. What's going to happen next is we have a videotape report which is going to set up the history of our changing nuclear strategy over the past 35, 40 years. That will take about 5.5 minutes, and then we will come to your questions.
Living with the threat of nuclear war once seemed so awesome that 20 years ago, Herman Kahn called one of his books on the subject, Thinking About the Unthinkable. But today, a substantial part of the world's population has grown to maturity without knowing anything but the nuclear age. Nightline correspondent Bill Redeker traces how U.S. nuclear strategy has changed through the decades.
Late 1945, the troops come home. A time of celebration and reunion. The end of World War II also brings a demobilization of our armed forces. The aftermath of Hiroshima and Nagasaki are a gruesome reminder that we have the bomb. We no longer need a massive army to deter potential aggressors.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your flags up.
In the 1950s, we become preoccupied with the rewards of our post-war industrial boom. New cars, new homes, hula hoops, and something else new, the building up of our nuclear arsenal to offset the vast armies of the Warsaw Pact. American deterrent strategy begins its heavy reliance on nuclear weapons and the threat to use them first. As Secretary of State John Foster Dulles puts it, more bang for the buck. His policy is called massive retaliation. If the Soviets dare cross the line, we'll respond with a strategic nuclear strike. But the Russians are also developing their nuclear arsenal. In the 1960s, Flower Children, Man on the Moon, the war in Vietnam, the demonstrations at home. By now, the Soviets are catching up with us in the nuclear arms race. Massive retaliation loses its credibility. President Kennedy replaces it with a new policy called flexible response. The threat to use conventional forces to meet a Soviet invasion of Europe, backed by nuclear weapons, including those based in the United States. The 60s also find the two superpowers eye to eye over Soviet missiles in Cuba. But America, with its superior nuclear arsenal, prevails. The missiles are removed. In the 1970s, the Vietnam War ends, and Watergate begins. Lines at the gas pumps, and America celebrates her 200th anniversary. Meanwhile, the Soviets achieve rough equality in nuclear weapons, and the 70s become the decade of nuclear arms control. SALT I codifies the balance of terror. Both sides seem to accept the fact they can destroy one another. Both sides are vulnerable. President Carter follows up the process with SALT II, signed in Vienna, but the decade of detente ends with new doubts. As Soviet armor rolls into Afghanistan, Christmas 1979. In the 1980s, Ronald Reagan takes office with a decidedly different view of the Soviets and their nuclear intentions. Reagan calls the Russians liars and cheaters. Furthermore, he maintains the Soviets do not accept the concept of mutual vulnerability and that they've adopted a policy to fight and win a nuclear war. The administration's evidence? An ambitious civil defense program by the Soviets to protect their citizens in a nuclear war. And a massive increase in long-range missiles.
The development and deployment of Soviet intercontinental ballistic missiles now pose a serious and increasing threat to a large part of our land-based ICBM force.
Meanwhile, Reagan's advisors and supporters say U.S. strategic forces have lagged behind.
We need very much to modernize our force. Don't forget that we haven't built a new missile, ICBM missile. We went almost 10 years without building it at all.
All of this, then, leads the president to the following conclusion.
The truth of the matter is that, on balance, the Soviet Union does have a a definite margin of superiority.
To right what Reagan perceives as a dangerous imbalance of forces, he proposes the greatest strategic buildup in this country's history, an array of forces, including new B-1 bombers, cruise missiles, Trident missiles and submarines, the MX, better control and command of these forces, and a civil defense program of our own.
The whole purpose of nuclear weapons is to prevent a nuclear war, but you're not going to prevent them if the other side doesn't believe that you could lick him if he started the war, okay? So you've got to have enough to convince him. In other words, you have to be able to use them to be sure that you won't use them.
Although no one really likes nuclear weapons, Western security is based on the threat to use them first if necessary.
Those in the West who advocate the adoption of no first use policy seldom go on to propose that the United States reintroduce the draft, triple the size of its armed forces, and put its economy on a wartime footing. Yet, in the absence of such steps, a pledge of no first use effectively leaves the West nothing with which to counterbalance the Soviet conventional advantages and geopolitical position in Europe.
So, simply put, the paradox of the nuclear age is that the awesome specter of destruction has so far prevented nuclear war. And until a way is found to eliminate all nuclear weapons, military strategists argue the nuclear standoff must be maintained. This is Bill Redeker for Nightline in Washington.
That's all the scene setting we're going to do. Now we are going to get to the main portion of this program, and that is the exchange between our guests here at Harvard and between our guests around the world. The first question, sir, is yours.
I'd like to pose my question to Mr. Burt. Mr. Burt, could you respond to the statement that President Reagan made that the United States, or that the Soviet Union, has a definite level of nuclear superiority and that the U.S. is threatened by a window of vulnerability? Do you agree with this assessment, this grave and dangerous remark?
Allow me to interrupt. If he doesn't, he's out of a job. But go ahead, Mr. Burt.
Thanks, Ted. But the truth, of course, is that I do agree with the assessment. And I don't just say that because I'm a Reagan administration official. What the president went on to say was that the Soviet Union, because it has deployed a new generation of very large and very accurate land-based missiles, has the capability to threaten the majority of American land-based missiles. And this was not a discovery by President Reagan. In fact, it was flatly stated by Secretary of Defense Harold Brown in the Carter administration. The president also went on to say that in the area of intermediate range ballistic missiles, those weapons that can threaten our allies that are deployed in the Soviet Union, that can be used against Western Europe, that the Soviet Union has 300 SS-20 missiles. Each one of those SS-20 missiles has three warheads. Thus, they have 900 nuclear warheads that can be used against our allies in Europe, and the United States has no equivalent capability. So the Soviet Union clearly has built up over the last 15 years very important advantages, both in the area of intercontinental ballistic forces and in intermediate range forces. And it's a fact of life that we have to deal with. We would like to deal with this fact of life through negotiations. And in Geneva right now, the president has offered a proposal which says that the West will forego the deployment of cruise missiles and Pershing II missiles in Europe if the Soviet Union agrees to eliminate altogether intermediate range ballistic missiles. We're prepared to eliminate that category of weapons altogether.
All right, Mr. Burt, we have standing by Mr. Gerasimov in Moscow. It seems appropriate at this point to go to him and ask him what the Soviet response to that offer is.
My impression is, unfortunately, I have feedback again. My impression is that Mr. Burt was selling his party line to me. I want to begin with a little history, just a moment, for the moment. We were not the initiator of the arms race. We were always catching up. It can easily be proved The first atomic bomb was yours. The first intercontinental strategic bomber was yours. Nuclear power submarine, you were the first to build it. Nuclear power aircraft carriers, you have them, we don't. MIRVs, you have them, you had them before us. Neutron weapons, you have them, we don't. So you, from our side, it was just a reaction to your action. And now we think that we have strategic parity. And you can argue then we have some margin on this particular system, but we can argue that you have margin on another system. For instance, the window of vulnerability, as I understand it, is, and our superiority is expressed by our capability, as you think, to destroy your land-based missiles. But no person in his right mind will destroy these missiles when everybody knows that you have two other legs of your strategic triad, submarines and bombers, which is more than enough to bring us unacceptable damage. So we do have parity. And the problem is how we read each other's intentions. And I assure you, we have no intention to attack Europe or United States for that matter.
All right, let me jump to one more guest, and that is Mr. Strauss in Munich. When you hear the two sides talking this way, you, of course, Mr. Strauss, have a great deal of personal expertise on this subject. What do you think? Both sides now claiming to have inferiority to the other side, or at least in the case of Mr. Gerasimov, claiming that there is now parity after all these years.
My first conclusion is that there are unreconcilable contradictions as far as the so-called zero option is concerned. The Soviets are evidently thinking that now there is an existing zero option because they have caught up. And the Americans say the Soviets must eliminate their mid-range ballistic missiles. Only doing so, or by an agreed parity of MRBMs, a solution can be found.
Let me interrupt
this
just for
would not
Mr. Strauss.
Lead to a real solution.
May I just interrupt for one?
Negotiations go on this way, they may last many years. I think of Vienna, of the mutual balance forces reduction debates, which are going on now for, I think, 9 or 10 years without any real result. We feel a concrete Soviet threat against West Germany, against Western Europe, by the deployment of SS-20 missiles, 300, each of them with 3 warheads, and we Germans are, in addition to that, within the range of the SS-4 and the SS-5, with about 600 or 700 miles range. We think if there is not a satisfactory outcome in Geneva, unfortunately, I would like to accentuate, unfortunately, we have to catch up in Western Europe by implementation of our nuclear arsenal within the NATO alliance.
All right, Mr. Strauss, the only reason I was trying to interrupt before is to ask you and to ask all of our guests this evening, because we are dealing with a terribly complex subject, where you can avoid using acronyms, where you can try to explain when you refer to something like zero option what it is. Let's go to our next questioner.
I would like to pose my question to Dr. Kissinger and Mr. Burt. There has been a very active and extensive grassroots movement that has emerged since President Reagan was elected that didn't exist while Dr. Kissinger was negotiating SALT I. And I would like to know whether you believe that the administration's present policies have inspired and, in fact, fueled this movement.
Dr. Kissinger?
Well, I believe that in the early stages of the administration, statements were made that created the impression of a certain callousness towards the use of nuclear weapons. And the arms control effort was not pushed with the same energy as the rearmament effort. I think this contributed to the atmosphere in which this movement has now developed. But it is also true that the administration dealt with a very real problem that has been described by Mr. Byrd, and that it was the conviction of the administration, as I understand it, that they would first do rearmament and then deal with negotiations. My own personal view was that those two processes should occur side by side. But this is a tactical issue. I think at this moment, the administration has committed itself to a serious and major arms control effort. And what we should now discuss is the nature of arms control and the definition of our security. So many of the things that have been said here really reflect the absence of an agreed notion of what a war should be like, what our security consists of, and therefore the absence of a consensus of what we can safely limit and what we can safely eliminate.
Dr. Kissinger, if I may jump in for a moment, the question is, I suppose, one of the questions is, how one goes about considering the use of nuclear weapons, the actual use thereof. We have a tendency to push that into the back part of our brains. We, the public, don't like to think about that. Therefore, we respond by saying, don't use them at all. Can you give us a sense of how nuclear weapons should be considered in a strategic doctrine in this day and age?
The dilemma is that if we announce that we will not use nuclear weapons, we are attempting nuclear blackmail. And if we announce even that we will not use them first, we may be tempting the impression that we would accept a conventional defeat rather than use weapons that now widely exist. On the other hand, I also believe that the reliance on the mass extermination of civilians as the principal strategy of the democracies is contrary to the moral convictions of our people, to political sense, and we therefore have to find a doctrine of defense in which we neither subject ourselves to nuclear blackmail nor have to rely on nuclear weapons as our principal means of deterrence. Now, I know I have not answered the question because of how I visualize the use, because that has been the unsolved problem for 30 years or more. Those who oppose nuclear weapons paradoxically talk about mass extermination being sufficient and therefore regulate the number of, or set the number of necessary weapons at a very low level. Those who are afraid that they might have to be used would like to find some military consequence, some military way they can be used without mass extermination if worst comes to worst. I started out in the book to which you referred criticizing the doctrine of massive retaliation, and I thought maybe limited nuclear war was an option. I must say, in fairness, in the 25 years since then, nobody has come up with a plausible scenario for limited nuclear war. So I now believe that the best policy for the West is to increase its reliance on conventional weapons. And my major difference with my former colleague, Mac Bundy, is that while I agree with many of the steps that he recommends for action, I would not make the declaration of no first use because we might not keep it and because it might tempt the belief that we would accept a conventional defeat in an area of major would accept a conventional defeat in an area of major concern to us, but our national debate has to address the question that you put. We have never given a satisfactory answer to it.
All right. We'll give Mr. Bundy a chance to respond in just a moment. There is only one moral imperative that is greater than that of avoiding nuclear war, and that's going to commercials. We'll be back with more questions from our guests, from our audience here at Harvard, in a moment.
Which one is it? Kennedy in.
I hear you not very loud and clear, but I hear you. Yeah, I hear you. Thank you.
All right. I will try and get it moving a little bit more quickly, ladies and gentlemen, but I must say there are times when I think we've got to let it go. The purpose of this is to elicit ideas, and we're beginning to do that. No, I'm going to go first to Mr. First we've got the bumper, then I'm going to go to Mr. Bundy, and then we'll go to the next question. Okay. He will. Yeah. Excuse me. May I ask you who your question is for? We have not yet gone to Dr. Molander, Dr. Kahn. Yes, you at the microphone. We haven't gone to Monsignor Kent. We haven't gone to Dr. Kahn. We haven't gone to Dr. Molander. If you could address your question to one of those, it would be very helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Back a few centuries to when God drove out Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden and forbade them to come
back in because they had eaten of the forbidden tree of knowledge. We have bitten in our generation, in my judgment, too deep into the tree of knowledge, and we've come up with weapons that can destroy civilization, destroy the entire human race.
The presence of nuclear in the world has created fear and distrust among nations, as it is one more weapon to destroy human life, God's beautiful presence in the world.
Any child understands that when you put block on block on block, finally the whole row of blocks comes tumbling down. And I sincerely believe that when you escalate the nuclear arms race and put weapon system on weapon system on weapon system, the inevitable result will be that the whole world will come tumbling down.
We have two pieces of unfinished business. Mr. Bundy.
Well, I wanted to say only that it does seem to me that the crucial point in the current exchange over how you use them is that nobody has a good answer to that. And that question becomes even harder if you ask who's going to use them first, because the more people look at what happens after they get going, the harder it is to give a confident answer to the question, how do you stop? And so I have concluded, and my friends have, and we hope that the country can conclude, that the only durable use for these weapons, and we can't get rid of them all. None of us, I think, thinks that. The only durable use for them is to prevent their use by others, and conventional threats should be met in other ways for which, if we have the will, we can find the means.
All right, Mr. Byrd in Washington, a few moments ago a question was addressed to Dr. Kissinger and to you. In fairness, you ought to have a chance to respond too.
Well, thanks, Ted. I just wanted to make a very brief and simple point, and that is that I think the new concern about nuclear weapons that's manifest today in the United States and in Western Europe is not just a simple reaction to what officials have said in the Reagan administration or what people have said generally. I think it's really a very normal and healthy return to thinking about some very critical East-West security problems. In some ways, since the late 1960s, Americans have been preoccupied with a range of other issues, from the Vietnam War, through the Watergate trauma, through the tragedy of the Iranian hostage situation, and constant attention to instability in the Third World, particularly the Middle East. I think it's only normal that having gone through that period, that we're returning to think about some very basic questions. And the Reagan administration welcomes this questioning, it welcomes this debate, and is prepared to engage in this debate.
All right, we'll go to our next questioner now, and would you please tell us to whom your question is addressed?
I'd like to address a question to both Monsignor Kent and to the gentleman in Moscow, Gerasimov.
Mr. Gerasimov.
Gerasimov, yes. I've been working with the Cambridge Committee for a Nuclear Weapons Freeze for about a year now, and I'm very, very, very acutely concerned about the buildup of nuclear arms. I do think that people, grassroots level people, will have to find a way to end this nuclear arms movement. And I'd like to ask both of those gentlemen what is being done in both of their countries right now on the grassroots level and what we can do here.
All right, Monsignor Kent, would you like to begin?
Well, in this country, I think we've created a great public awareness about this business. We've got a very sensible campaign with our own government because Britain is a so-called independent nuclear power, and I think now we have, I would say, a majority opinion with us against the new weapon systems that our government is proposing. And we've done that in all kinds of ways, work with schools, doctors, trade unions, teachers, the mothers' groups, all across the country, and in local authorities too. We now have 140 local authorities declaring themselves nuclear-free zones. I'd like to say that there are so many simple, basic things that we can actually get over that make sense. This idea that the SS-20s create something new, I'm amazed at Mr. Burt's figures. He entirely leaves out all the Western arsenals which can actually strike the Soviet Union now. We cannot be conned, that's an English expression, conned by the kind of sophistries which are at present about. And I believe that ordinary people now perfectly well realize that no new weapons are required and that the new weapons coming have a technology of their own. People talk about first use as if it was something that was just a matter of discussion. First use only makes sense if somehow you think a nuclear war can be stopped at a certain stage. And nobody thinks that. And I think these simple, basic facts we have got over in large measure to our community in this country. And I thank God for it.
All right, Mr. Gerasimov, I don't know whether the term grassroots is familiar to you. Is it?
Oh, yes. We have our grassroots, too.
Well, tell us about the grassroots efforts in the Soviet Union to bring about a free
First of all, I want to thank Mr. Kent for his very good description of the balance of nuclear forces in Europe and what we can really feel. Also, maybe just for a minute about no first strike or no first use of nuclear weapons, if I may. Okay?
Oh, sure. Go ahead.
You see, we are very much worried about this talk of potential for the first strike. And we see new weapon systems which are being developed on the other side of the ocean as systems which have this potential of first strike against us. And as you know, the position of my government is no first use of nuclear weapons. And as you know, Mr. Haig is definitely against it, even before he read that article in Foreign Affairs magazine recommending this. And I remember Mr. McNamara interview for Los Angeles Times where he said that when he was Secretary for Defense, Air Force was insisting on acquiring first strike potential. And we know now from plans which are now being published, for instance, drop shot, that there were ideas to deliver first strike against us. Also, earlier in the program, you said that this administration doesn't think that we accept the concept of mutual vulnerability, but we do accept. We know that we are vulnerable, and we said many times that there can be no winner in a nuclear exchange.
And now,
as to our grassroots movement,
yes,
returning to the grassroots, yes?
Please.
Yes, we have our peace movement, we have our peace committee, and the difficulty on the other side to understand is that there is no big conflict between the Soviet people who do want peace and the government who says that we are vulnerable, that we are against first use, that we are for peace, that we are for disarmament. And for instance, there is an impression sometimes in your country that we don't know about the catastrophic consequences of a nuclear exchange. We do know, and as my bedtime reading, I had this Jonathan Schell book. Also, we have our own books on this.
I'm surprised you didn't have it in the New Yorker. All right,
well,
may I at this point jump back to this country and to Chicago, to Dr. Roger Molander. You know, in honor of Ground Zero Week, there were, in fact, a couple of demonstrations in the Soviet Union. I think two people tried to demonstrate in Red Square, and they were arrested within 5 minutes. How do you feel about the parity in that sense? There really hasn't been this kind of program in the Soviet Union, has there?
No, and I don't think we can wait to work this problem with the Soviet Union until there is, if you will, a democracy in which that sort of thing can take place. Clearly, we have to work this problem with the Soviet leadership. American people, American government together, working it with the Soviet leadership. We have no illusions about that.
All right, let's go to our next question, please.
Hi, I address my question to Mr. Burt. I was wondering, I can't conceive of any kind of life after a nuclear war, and I wonder if you could describe your picture of what it would be like.
Well, I certainly can't conceive of life after a nuclear war, and all I can do is just answer very briefly by saying what President Reagan said recently at his press conference, that no one would win. We can't conceive of a winner. Both sides would be a loser.
Professor Kahn, would you like to express some opinions on that subject?
Well, I literally think the position is dead wrong. First and foremost, there is no respectable study that indicates that all human life would be destroyed by a nuclear war. Jonathan Schell based his particular remarks on the National Academy study, and they would like to have come out with that answer, but they could not. Now, we've never tried the experiment, so nobody knows what's going to happen. That's quite clear. We have exploded a large number of nuclear weapons in the Pacific, and we know the second thing, that nuclear wars come in all sizes and shapes. The general picture that you press every button in the house and go home is the least likely thing that's going to happen. The Russians are terrified of nuclear war. We're terrified of nuclear war. It's not going to be an exuberant experience one bit. And you're not going to go, you know, people get the idea that there's only one possible course of events. If somebody tells you that he wants to use a nuclear weapon, he can keep the war limited, he's obviously crazy. If somebody tells you that somebody else used a nuclear weapon and it has to escalate to the ultimate, he's equally crazy. You just don't know. In any particular circumstances, you can make a judgment. In most of the scenarios we look at, our judgment is that it doesn't escalate in the quite that exuberant fashion. We may be wrong, we may be right, but we try to do it as well as we can. It is absolutely correct that the Soviet Union is vulnerable to nuclear disasters just as we are. On the other hand, every military paper I've seen in the Soviet Union argues what we call a war-fighting position, and I think they're basically right. The Soviets talk about a revolution in warfare. They talk about big changes. And they also talk about a lot of continuities. And just to talk about the changes, not about the continuities, is kind of dumb on a very serious issue. You don't need slogans. You need some facts, to the extent that you have facts. And the idea that all nuclear wars explode to the top is just about as dumb as you can get.
All right. We'll be back with more questions from our audience here at Harvard in a moment.
Would you get what you got if you could have got an Oldsmobile?
Well, this gets good mileage.
But if a Cutlass Supreme offered the same kind of mileage...
Would you get what you got if...
You could have got a Cutlass?
You bet. You could have. Even a roomy Delta 88.
An 88?
Even an 88.
A Cutlass Sierra 2?
Here's great news.
12.8% financing is available now through May 31st on new Oldsmobiles.
You could have got an Oldsmobile.
Come, explore the Minolta XGM. Feel how precisely it fits your hand. Expand your talents with professional motor drive, nearly 50 exceptional Minolta lenses, and a super bright computerized viewfinder. The results are stunning, yet all you do is focus and shoot. That's the wonder of the XGM. Only from the mind of Minolta.
Make it comfortable. Good.
That was comfortable.
I've been giving my daughter tips on driving, and here's another important one. If you drive a car, you need premium performance tires. So I put Bridgestone Superfiller radios on Leslie's car. The hard rubber Superfiller here lets the sidewall flex, so you get a big footprint of rubber for cornering, braking, handling, and comfort, too.
They're comfortable, Pop, and they're performers.
That's right. You can feel it when you drive. Bridgestone Superfiller steel-belted radios. See the yellow pages for a Bridgestone dealer near you.
Last year, swarms of gypsy moth caterpillars ruined yards and made thousands of people angry.
They were on the trees, the house, even the car.
I could hear them crunching at night.
But new Raid gypsy moth and Japanese beetle killer kills bugs fast. Just a twist mixes the concentrate and shoots a trace of foam into trees and shrubs to kill bugs on contact. New Raid gypsy moth and Japanese beetle killer kills bugs dead with just a twist.
Good evening. At the top of the news, at the top of the hour, the top story tonight takes us to the State House, where the status is still the same. Economic news from Washington was worse Wednesday. That's the second week we witnessed worse.
Do you ever get the feeling that some of the TV stations try to rush you through the news?
Just in, thank you.
On News Center 5, our special checkpoint team takes the time to tell you the complete story, covering the major news events in New England in depth as they break.
Would Proposition 2.5% partial payment to people unprotected by pension plans? Probably. Let's go to the phones for live reports. Larry, are there any good Daniel
Checkpoint. Special investigative reports only on News Center 5 at 6.
The nuclear age began when Japan was bombed with nuclear weapons. There's no reason on earth why the same principles that have obtained throughout history would not still obtain in a nuclear age. They were expressed best by Rome, who said, "Si vis pacem, para bellum." If you want peace, be prepared for war.
I think we take a page out of the book of the Vietnam War. The Vietnam War was probably the first time in the history of this country when young people taught a moral lesson to older people. They marched and they shouted and they carried signs, did all kinds of things, but the most important thing they did, they convinced their elders that this was a bad thing. And once the elders were convinced, political action followed upon it, and that was the end of it.
Well, they collected the wounded and the crippled maimed, and they sent
us. We can protest, we can pick it. We can talk about it, but you can't stop the superpowers from making bombs. You can't stop the Army and Navy if they go to war. So all we can do is pray.
And now we will go back to our questions. You, sir.
Mr. Bundy, in your article in Foreign Affairs, you call for renunciation by America of the first use of atomic weapons. Isn't this tantamount to abandoning the defense of Western Europe and South Korea? That is, it would seem that at least in the short run, the conventional forces arrayed against those countries by their enemies are overwhelming, so that it would be, you do argue that it could lead Western Europe, for instance, to develop their conventional forces, but they don't have those conventional forces now, and they might not have the political will to raise the money to build them. Can Western Europe and South Korea defend themselves with wishful thinking against Soviet armies?
Well, I think myself that there is plenty of capability, and it is a question of will in Western Europe. And I should make one correction. We didn't intend to ask, and I don't think the article does ask, for an immediate declaration, but rather for a prompt and careful study by citizens and governments of the ways and means of moving to what strikes us as a much less dangerous, more civilized, basically, more civilized policy. And I quite agree that it would take time to do that. How much time, I think, honestly, no one knows. There are very widely different estimates as to how strong and effective the conventional balance in Europe is now. And I do not think that Secretary Haig's estimates would be widely accepted. They seem to me and to many others unconsidered and excessive. But what is needed is to find out what we want for a balance in Europe, and careful study should help us all to come to a decision, and I think to find the will, both here and in Europe, to do whatever is necessary. The same thing holds with changes with respect to particular responsibilities in the case of Korea, where I do not think a first use by the United States is essential to the maintenance of the peace there.
Next question.
Okay, I'll address this to Dr. Kissinger, but the question is general enough for anyone to answer. Most of the debate on nuclear weapons recently has centered around the U.S.-Soviet standoff. How much danger do you see in the spread of nuclear weapons to governments with unstable regimes, to governments with unpredictable leaders, for example, Libya's Gaddafi, and to political or terrorist organizations?
Before I answer this question, may I make one comment to Mr. Gerasimov, because I don't know when I get the floor again.
Go ahead.
I cannot accept the proposition that the United States is primarily responsible for the arms race. I think we have to face the fact that at the end of the war, the United States wanted nothing more than withdraw from Europe, and all its plans were made on that basis. And the experience of the post-war period has been one of Soviet pressure in very many areas of the world. And without a recognition that there has to be some political restraint, without an acceptance of some canons of international conduct, we will constantly live in an atmosphere of international tension which tempts arms races of some sort, including in the nuclear field. And
to the so-called revisionist school of the history of the Cold War. So I'm not sure I can find the common ground, Mr. Kissinger, about the responsibility for the post-war arms race. But I remember earlier in the program, I don't see it, I can only hear it. So you are more fortunate than I am. But there was something about post-war boom in your country. We were the winner in the last war, but there was no boom. It was a period of very hard times. It was a period of recovery. And military aggression was very far from our minds. But American atomic bomb was very close to our fears.
I'm sure that Afghanistan is delighted that things are so much better now.
You see, you have your own opinion on Afghanistan, but in the context of our discussion, the thing that I want to emphasize is that Sol 2 was torpedoed and almost buried before Afghanistan.
All right, may we now go to the question, we're hopscotching around a little bit, but the question was about the proliferation of nuclear weapons, particularly in the hands of the irresponsible like Muammar Gaddafi. Dr. Kissinger.
I agree with the thrust of the question. I think the proliferation of nuclear weapons into the hands of more and more irresponsible countries is one of the grave dangers of our period. It is an issue on which all the existing nuclear powers seem to me to have a common interest to prevent the further proliferation of nuclear weapons. And it is one of the problems requiring the most urgent attention, and in which all our governments, all the nuclear powers, should cooperate at least to keep the danger level where it is now so that it can be reduced from that level.
Monsignor Kent, would you like to approach this subject?
I think the proliferation issue is one of the gravest dangers. We are seeing country after country is no longer a superpower balance, but we have five countries that acknowledge, probably two others that have, Israel, India, South Africa detonating something. We're now in a situation where the Argentine has a bomb. You Americans are anxious to put cruise missiles in Sicily, which is ludicrous from a strategic point of view because it's 2 hours further to the Soviet Union, but it's much closer to Gaddafi. And in fact, this so-called stability of deterrence is quite visibly breaking down everywhere. And when we talk about defending Europe, frankly, what we are frightened of in Europe is the development of the weapons technology that brings first strike perceptions closer and closer. The Pershing 2 missiles that are meant to go to West Germany, they fly into the Soviet Union faster, twice as fast as it takes for the Soviets to fire their intercontinental land-based missiles. Imagine the degree of instability being created. And there's no way you can contain this Pandora's box. If nuclear weapons are good for Britain and good for America and good for Russia, then they're good for anybody who can get hold of them. And that's the way the world is going until some voices of sanity are heard. And we haven't heard very many this evening, I'm sorry to say.
Well, we'll come back to you again later. If I may, I'd like once again to remind our audience here that we only eat into time when we hiss, applaud, boo, anything else. Let's stick with the exchange of ideas. We'll be back with more of those from Harvard University in a moment.
The secret of the Colombian coffee bean was passed from the grandfather of Juan Valdez to the father of Juan Valdez, and then to Juan. For in Colombia, it is an art to pick the coffee bean at the moment of perfect ripeness. It is an art that is passed from generation to generation to generation. It is no accident that Colombian coffee is the richest coffee in the world. It is a national heritage.
Why is Valerie living her rocky marriage one day at a time? Inquiring minds want to know.
I want to know.
Who is the old flame that brought Liz new romance? This week's National Enquirer tells you. How can deep breathing techniques help cure insomnia? Who are Hollywood's best and worst tippers?
It's in the Enquirer.
How can this super psychic make live objects appear from thin air? Find out in the Enquirer. Over 100 features for people with inquiring minds.
Like me.
If we fire nuclear weapons first at the Soviet Union, we'll be committing suicide.
The Soviet Union would do more damage to us than we would do to them.
I think that we ought to slow the arms race, reduce the upward spiral of nuclear weapons.
We cannot get there by unilaterally moving to our own disadvantage.
There may be a few people that will survive. They will probably envy the dead.
Question.
Ted, my question is a follow-up to the whole issue of irresponsibility, and it can be answered by any of the Americans. What checks exist to prevent a temporarily deranged president from launching a first strike, and have they ever been used?
All right, Dr. Molander, you were on the National Security Council for a while, and obviously this is a concern of yours also. Why don't you address the question in general terms?
Well, first of all, I don't think there's much chance of that happening, quite obviously. But there are really checks. Messages from the president have to pass through the Secretary of Defense and through the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and I really don't think that that's a real challenge to the problem of preventing nuclear war.
All right, what then is the biggest danger of nuclear war? I mean, we keep hearing, and I'm hearing so many different arguments this evening that all seem to say no kind of nuclear war is possible, and yet everyone here and people around the country are concerned about precisely the specter of nuclear war being inevitable.
Well, it's clearly that someday that there might be a crisis someplace, like in the Persian Gulf or the Middle East, and that escalation would gradually start. First, maybe conventional weapons used by a couple of countries there, gradually the United States and the Soviet Union becoming involved, because, of course, in most parts of the world, we are on opposite sides, and rather than dampening any crisis, would be amplifying it, and that eventually you might get to the point where the superpowers are actually in conflict, that leading to initial use of nuclear weapons in a situation like we see in the Falklands now, where we're wondering who is going to back down. That kind of scenario is the thing that really worries most people.
All right, let's go to our next question.
Yes, I have a question about civil defense for Mr. Burt and Mr. Molander. How likely do you think it is that the United States will have sufficient warning of an impending Soviet nuclear attack to make it possible to relocate some 450 urban centers And furthermore, what will stop the Soviet Union from retargeting to those relocation centers? And lastly, is it possible that we're sending some sort of signal that we're preparing for an offensive strike ourselves if we're showing the world that we're moving all our populations and getting ready for nuclear war?
All right, Mr. Byrd.
Well, I think those are all good questions. I think the first answer that has to be given is that there right now is a very important asymmetry in the civil defense capabilities of the United States and the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union does take civil defense very seriously. The Central Intelligence Agency has estimated that the Soviet Union spends somewhere in the vicinity of $2 billion a year on civil defense. They have the capability of protecting their leadership. They're prepared to protect important industries, and they appear to have a very well worked out crisis relocation program. The Reagan administration has a much smaller program. We're looking at the possibility of relocating people. We don't know any of those questions on warning. It's possible that we may have warning. It's possible that we won't. But we think a prudent civil defense program makes sense. We don't believe it's destabilizing because we don't believe in the final analysis that we could protect the entire American population from an extensive nuclear attack. But that does not mean that we should ignore the possibility that many millions of Americans might be saved by some low-cost, prudent measures.
Dr. Molander, isn't civil defense at the moment a laugh?
Well, in the early 1960s, there was another plan for a big civil defense program that really went to the people, and the people clearly rejected it. Individual citizens, as we say in Ground Zero, can make up their own minds about this issue. Clearly, to bring people out of the cities with warning of 5 to 7 days and put them into the countryside really just puts them into a post-war world, which we all know will be a struggle for survival. Uncontaminated water, problems of medical supplies, problems of even obtaining food, and certainly you're probably going to see a breakdown in social and political order, real anarchy. The question is that where we should spend our money, or should we spend our money in other ways that might reduce the possibility of war?
All right, Professor Kahn, if that is true of civil defense efforts here in the United States, why then is it that we are concerned in any fashion about civil defense preparations in the Soviet Union? What is it they know that we don't?
They know a good deal. First of all, civil defense is easier for them. They only have about 12% of their people in large cities of over a million. We have almost a half, so it would be more difficult for us to evacuate. But we have a lot more automobiles. We have this great highway system. And I think it's quite clear that you can evacuate your cities in something like 3 to 5 days, maybe less. They can't, if you've done it properly, they can't retarget because the people are spread out much more. They are much less vulnerable. The casualties go down by an order of magnitude. You don't really expect to do civil defense crisis location on warning. You expect to do it in a crisis. If the Soviets evacuate their cities, the bargaining situation is absolutely intolerable unless you do something the same. It's very dangerous to do the same thing because you do get a situation of what people call reciprocal fear of surprise attack. Each one fears the others may strike. The situation is not as bad in the immediate future because the Soviets have this kind of superiority. We're not going to strike them. But still, it's a dangerous thing to do. Now, the main argument for civil defense, though, is very, very inexpensive things save a lot of lives if you're not in a target area. And very few people in most of the wars we look at are in target areas. It is difficult to protect people from weapons directed at them unless they are very spread out. The war can happen. You'll be first saving lives and not saving lives. It's just that simple.
Let's go to our next question.
At the moment, the United States has about 9,000 nuclear missiles and the Soviet Union about 7,000 strategic nuclear missiles. All of these missiles, and this is about rough parity, all of these missiles are based in silos and in submarines and can easily be detected. Any freeze, any attempt to limit nuclear weapons requires a verifiable treaty. But with the introduction of a cruise missile, which is very small and mobile and can be hidden anywhere, the idea of a verifiable treaty is almost negated. If we don't have a freeze now, won't cruise missiles eliminate the possibility of having any limitation on nuclear weapons? And I guess,
Dr. Kissinger, why don't you address the question of the possible destabilizing effects of the cruise missile?
Well, I think the numbers that the questioner gave are too high. I think the Soviet Union has something like 1,400 missiles in silos, and we have about 1,000 in silos. But that, I suppose he meant warheads on the missiles. But that isn't the key issue. The cruise missile, I believe, makes it somewhat more difficult to have an arms control agreement. On the other hand, I believe also that the that any realistic assessment has to take into account that the cruise missiles will exist and are existing now.
Forgive me for interrupting, but just explain why does a cruise, what is a cruise missile, well, why does it have missile, a destabilizing effect?
A cruise missile is similar to the German V-1. It is a pilotless airplane, or it is on the model of a pilotless airplane that can be launched from submarines or ships or land, or in fact, and from airplanes. In SALT II, specific provisions are made for cruise missiles and how they are to be counted, so that the existence of cruise missiles is not an insuperable obstacle to the existence of arms control agreements. And I think any arms control agreements in the future will have to take into account the existing cruise missile systems and find some way of counting them, as was in fact done under SALT II. I would like to, if I could make one comment about a previous point that was made, about the danger of how a nuclear war might break out. I think it could break out the way Mr. Molander described, which is more the model of, say, World War I, where equally matched sides are misjudging each other's capability. It could break out the way World War II broke out, in which one side thinks it has an advantage, rightly or wrongly, and produces a Holocaust. And it could break out if one side disarms itself psychologically, and if all the pressures against nuclear weapons are aimed at the populations of one side, while the leadership of the other country is in a position in which it has much greater freedom of action. So that in our public debate, we ought to keep all these three dangers in mind and not bring about unilateral disarmament by the best intentions in the world.
We'll continue our question and answer session with our guests in a moment. Let's go right to our next questioner. Yes, sir.
I'm curious to know how Mr. Molander, Mr. Gerasimov, and others feel about the most widely discussed arms control proposal now in existence, namely the mutual and verifiable freeze proposal, namely a freeze on the testing, production, and deployment of nuclear warheads and all delivery systems. Since SALT and other conventional arms control methods have not prevented proliferation or development of the new generation of nuclear armaments, I would like to know what the objection is to the mutual and verifiable freeze proposal.
First of all, I have never heard the word verifiable used in the nuclear freeze program, but let's go to the people to whom you address the question. Dr. Molander?
Well, as everyone knows, Ground Zero is a nonpartisan project, but I think it's important to note that the nuclear freeze campaign provides a very useful and badly needed way for the American people to confront the nuclear war issue. It also provides an important vehicle for people to express their concern about the possibility of nuclear war and about the arms race itself. And it's really a message to the leaders that says, stop it, halt the arms race. The particular freeze proposal itself, you know, I think you really couldn't take it to Moscow or even the Kennedy-Hatfield or the Jackson-Warner. None of them are at the level of detail of a real arms control proposal yet.
All right, Mr. Gerasimov.
Well, for me, nuclear freeze idea is a good idea. Actually, it's a grassroots idea, first expressed by Randall Forsberg of Boston. Even better idea may be sold too, because by that agreement, we were to cut our forces a little bit. Now, about verification. It is one of the obstacles in the arms controls, arms control talks. And I want to say a few words, just a minute or even less, about cruise missiles. They are really destabilizing, and they are very difficult to verify. and we suggested the Soviet side to stop this particular channel of arms race and not to develop cruise missiles. It could really help in the future when the question of verification could come up. Maybe also two or three words on civil defense. It is one of the paradoxes of the nuclear age that civil defense, if it is good enough, may be really destabilizing, because then you can think that the other side is preparing war fighting capability. I remember that when I was in your country, I saw here, there, and everywhere black and yellow signs of fallout shelters. And I even found in the basement of the house where I lived civil defense all-purpose survival crackers. It's very big.
It's one of our big strategic secrets, Mr. Gerasimov.
Actually, I keep it as a souvenir. This big can, it's 6¾ pound can.
Don't
open
it
in my house.
Most of them are spoiled.
As a souvenir.
Mr. Burt.
Yeah, I would tell him not to eat any
of
those crackers.
Just a second. Just one word. Just one last word, okay?
Go ahead.
The last word is that I want any American who is in Moscow, in Leningrad, or any other city of the Soviet Union, I want them to show me these signs for shelters. And this is one example to show the real scale of our very modest civil defense effort.
Okay, Rick Burt.
Ted, I just wanted to make a quick point about cruise missiles and the word destabilizing, which I think is thrown around quite a deal and not terribly well defined. A destabilizing weapon is either a weapon that's vulnerable and thus offers an invitation to attack in the kind of crisis situation that Roger Molander was talking about, or it's a weapon that can be used for an attack, and it has the accuracy and the speed to be a first strike weapon. And cruise missiles don't have that attribute, particularly the speed. They are not a first strike weapon. In fact, the most destabilizing weapons are the large land-based ICBM systems that the Soviet Union deploys. They are systems that are vulnerable to attack, but more importantly, with a number of very accurate warheads, they can be used in a first strike. And I think any serious effort at arms control has got to focus on these large destabilizing systems.
Next question.
Yes, this is Dr. Kissinger.
Would you come closer to the microphone, please?
This to Dr. Kissinger. Alexander Ginsberg spoke today here at Harvard, and one of the things he said was this: you cannot sign a meaningful treaty with a closed society. Now, given the recent fairly clear-cut evidence that the Soviets have violated the chemical warfare treaties, how meaningful is it to negotiate with the Soviet Union? When one sits down to sign a SALT agreement, does one really believe that there's any sincerity on the other side?
No, one does not assume that there is any sincerity in our sense. One assumes that there's a mutuality of interest, and one hopefully has negotiated adequately so that the verification procedures that are agreed to, or that the weapons that are being limited, are so noticeable that violations can be determined. One does not rely on the Soviet Union's good faith in carrying out the agreement. The difficulty with the chemical warfare agreement was that there really was no method of verification, and that the assumption was that if the Soviet Union violated it by building up chemical weapons, then we would have other means by which we could react. But there was no, there were no verification procedures in the chemical warfare agreements. In the SALT agreements, I think I'm not familiar with any significant violations or with any violations that have occurred, because the weapons can be are of a size and of a nature, and our intelligence capabilities are of a nature by which we could monitor the agreement.
All right, forgive me, if I may jump in here, I have to make an announcement to our affiliates, and that is, while we were scheduled to go off the air at 1 o'clock Eastern Time, we are going to continue on a little bit beyond that. We have a great many more questions here to be asked, and I hope our guests will be tolerant and stay with us. We'll be back with more in a moment.
I think one thing to be said for this era is that if diplomacy ever mattered, it matters in a thermonuclear age, because the dangers of war and the between the superpowers or other countries that might have this technology are so enormous, so incredible, so dangerous, that diplomacy is absolutely vital, it seems to me, to all of us, all mankind.
In itself, nuclear war means that at any time we are condemned to disappear. That's it. We are all like people under a death sentence, and we wait. We wait for the execution. Can we leave? Live with that permanent anguish?
Question.
I'd like to address my question to the party officials, Mr. Burt and Mr. Strauss, and perhaps to Mr. Gerasimov. This discussion seems to have gotten very highbrow and very intellectual here. But what I'm really concerned with is what is going to make the United States press that button first, and what is going to make the Soviet Union press its button first.
Well, you've gotten right to it, haven't you? Let's go to Mr. Burt first.
Well, the answer to that question is that we never want to press that button. The strategy is simply one of deterrence. We have no plans to fight a nuclear war. We have no plans for winning a nuclear war. The whole strategy of flexible response, which is not a Reagan administration strategy, it's a strategy that the West has operated under for over 20 years, has been to tell any aggressor that at any level of conflict, conventional through nuclear, that the risks of actually trying aggression are too great to even contemplate.
All right, Mr. Gerasimov.
We said we are not going to push that button first. Actually, as a matter of fact, our strategy is, we don't use these words, but it boils down to mutual assured destruction position and not assured survival, as in Washington now.
All right, let's go to West Germany. Mr. Strauss, does any of that reassure you or scare the hell out of you?
I have been listening with great attention to the exchange of views on this matter. I think we should make a clear distinction between a preventive war, which I think to be completely impossible. Nobody will afford to wage it, definitely not the Americans, and I think also the Russians, because the Russians have always showed a high degree of awareness of risk. They are aware of risk, they are shy against risks. What I would not definitely exclude is a so-called preemptive strike, but I think the prerequisites for a preemptive strike are so selective and are so, on one hand, and so unclear on the other hand, that I think the ambiguity whether or not a preemptive strike is possible is more helpful to deter a war then the danger of that ambiguity can be assessed. So I think that no statesman will press the button first because a nuclear war is unthinkable. After the end of World War I, one could imagine how a World War II, which unfortunately was not prevented or avoided, might begin. Weapons technology has changed so rapidly and so drastically that nobody can imagine what a war, a nuclear war means. And I think this is as long helpful and as long indispensable as, now let me say, all superpowers, I would definitely address myself to the Soviet Union, would come back to the conduct, to the rule of international conduct. We Germans have been at war in our history many, many times against France. We need no deterrence more against France. We need no deterrence against Great Britain. France does not need a deterrence vis-a-vis Germany, and Great Britain does not need a deterrence vis-a-vis Germany. This means because we have more identical interests, we have no basic differences, and as long as those basic differences between the free democracies and the communist part of the world will continue, we cannot renounce nuclear weapons, we cannot unilaterally disarm, because the only consequence would be unconditional surrender.
All right, I'd like to go to another question. First of all, I have a small apology to make, or a correction. The Kennedy-Hatfield nuclear freeze resolution has just been handed to me. It does indeed call for mutual and verifiable freeze on the testing. My mistake. Let's go to the next question.
Yes, a follow-up to Mr. Gerasimov on the civil defense issue. We are told by our government that a crisis relocation plan is vital because your nation has one. Yet, in part, according to our analysts, that calls for 17 million of your people to walk 20 miles from Moscow, which would take about 30 hours, then to each dig a hole. That strikes me as about as ridiculous as our plans. And aren't we, in fact, creating a plan that is ridiculous in response to a plan that is ridiculous? And the cumulative result is it brings us both closer to the brink.
Mr. Gerasimov?
Well, if I can answer with a personal observation, never in my life have I been in to any civil defense drill. And I find arguments against civil defense, especially evacuation, I find arguments in this Jonathan Schell book, The Fate of the Earth, quite convincing. It's just transporting death from one place to another.
All right, let's go to another question.
This is from Monsignor Kent. Judging from the large size of the European nuclear disarmament rallies, it strikes me that Europeans may have a healthier and saner fear of nuclear war than most Americans. I wondered if you attributed that, if you think it is true, to the fact that in recent memory, European societies have suffered aerial bombardment of civilian populations and therefore find it easier to understand what nuclear warfare might mean to their countries. And if you think that's true, if you have any thoughts on how we might bring that immediacy to America.
I don't really think that is the case, because most people would have to be well into middle age now to really have known aerial bombardment, and the peace movement is very much a young movement in this country. I think films like Peter Watkins' War Game and other films like The Bomb with Jonathan Dimbleby, these have really shown people the reality. And I think that the civil defense program here, which the government has proposed, has been so absurd, hiding under the kitchen table and the stairs. People have realized this deterrence is not actually believed in by the government, ultimately, and yet the protection offered is so absurd. I think also from American militarists, and thank God they're not all Americans, but American militarists' language about fighting and winning nuclear wars in Europe, that has done a great deal to wake people up. But I don't really think it is a Second World War memory, because few of us, I'm young enough to remember flying bombs, but most people in the peace movement didn't know war, don't know war, and certainly are horrified by the kind of war that is described to them with nuclear weapons.
All right, we've got time for two more questions. You, sir.
Yes, thank you. This question is directed to any one of these gentlemen. Since the international nuclear regulatory agencies and Western nations seem to be either unwilling or unable to stop the transfer of sophisticated technology, nuclear technology and materials to nations such as South Africa and Israel, what other actions might the world community take, including West Germany, United States, and Britain, in stopping the flow of these particular materials and other sophisticated technology? Might we consider sanctions of some sort?
All right, George Bundy.
Well, I think the question is first class and the answer very difficult. Unlike the danger of nuclear weapons between the superpowers, the dangers of proliferation and the means of proliferation are much harder to sort out, much harder to control. The questioner obviously understands that point because of his reference to the fact that many nations are involved. I think that the most obvious missing piece of a serious policy, as distinct from declarations of interest, right now among the nuclear powers is the effort to make a concerted attack on the problems of proliferation. And it is, as
go by, that we can keep the peace. I think earlier in this program, someone mentioned the fact that while the sword of Damocles of nuclear war has hung over the heads of people in Eastern and Western Europe and the United States and the Soviet Union, that there have been over 100 wars throughout the Third World. And those wars have gone on. They have been very damaging wars. Thousands and millions of people have died. We have not had a war between East and West. The nuclear weapons are a reality. I don't think it's possible now to put that genie back in the bottle. Responsible people in Moscow, Washington, and in Europe are going to have to work very hard to manage that reality. We believe that by maintaining deterrence, by maintaining an equilibrium in capabilities, and while taking responsible efforts to reduce the levels of nuclear weapons on both sides, that your child has a bright future to look forward to.
I'll have a closing thought in a moment. What's important, to borrow Dr. Kahn's phrase, is to begin thinking about the unthinkable and talking about it in the manner of a nation that prizes the rational over the dogmatic. It's all too easy to caricature those with whom we disagree as warmongers on the one hand or communist dupes on the other. It is easy to reduce nuclear war to an absurdity. It's worse than that. It is the ultimate obscenity. But that's simply stating the obvious. To apply to the problem the proper mixture of realism and humanity, to take national interest into account even as we set our course toward the distant goal of global brotherhood, is infinitely more demanding and in the long run more worthwhile. There will be a lot of marches and demonstrations in the months to come. They are relatively uncomplicated affairs and they usually carry a high emotional impact. We in television will cover them. They are largely designed to be covered by television. And there will be speeches and news conferences by our leaders. They are also designed for television, to register the highest emotional impact on the largest possible audience. It will be difficult to remember at times that the issue transcends opposition to nuclear war. Nuclear war has very few devoted advocates. We can freeze nuclear weapons. We can reduce their numbers. In theory, at least, we can even eliminate them altogether. But as Jonathan Schell recently pointed out, our dilemma is that we can never eliminate the knowledge of how to build nuclear weapons. That will be with us for as long as we survive. Learning to live with that knowledge is our problem. Our thanks go to our distinguished panel of guests and to our equally distinguished audience here at Harvard University. Special appreciation is due to the John F. Kennedy School of Government. They have been gracious and thoughtful hosts. Tomorrow, another special Nightline broadcast. Our live guest will be former President Jimmy Carter. He'll be talking to us from Plains, Georgia, on the subject of this weekend's Israeli withdrawal from the Sinai, the fruit of Camp David. That's our report for tonight. I'm Ted Koppel at Harvard. For all of us here at ABC News, good night.
If you could only appreciate what you put your car through. Road grime, bad weather, extremes in temperature. Give your car a break. Go to your Napa Auto Parts store or to participating garages and stations during Napa Spring Car Care Days and keep your car in shape for the months ahead. Because out on the streets, things can be pretty tough. For your domestic or import car, look for this sign of spring.
The day begins, so does the magic. Lights turn off automatically. You're in control. Managing information. Managing productivity. Managing energy. Managing costs. Managing change. And that's just some of the ways a Bell Business System can help you manage better. Want to see them again? Call your Bell System account executive. The Knowledge Business.
Hello, I'm...
By popular demand, Crimson Travel's fabulous one-week money-saving summer tour to America's national parks. Round-trip jets, 7 nights accommodations, transportation, and admissions, too. Enjoy the majesty of the Grand Canyon, Yellowstone, Old Faithful, Bryce, Zion, Grand Teton, Salt Lake City, and Las Vegas. Reservations made now will be confirmed at last year's rate, only $699 plus tax and service. Visit Nevada, Arizona, Utah, Idaho, Montana, and Wyoming. Call Crimson Travel now.
You're looking at the most exciting innovation in long distance since the telephone.
This is my telephone, so what's exciting?
Sprint, because Sprint can save you up to 50% on long distance using just your push-button phone.
Oh, sure.
Sprint specializes in long distance.
I could use the specialist.
Well, if long distance is costing you $25 a month or more, call Sprint.
What's that number?
800-521-4949. Sprint, the long distance specialist.
Hi, Louise.
Hi, Sam.
In Louisville, Kentucky, even blind people can read menus. In Vernon Parish, Louisiana, Fred Keck can easily get to his backyard.
Thank you.
In Champaign, Illinois, Alan Burton has a place to play with the rest of the kids. All this happened because a group of local people, both able and disabled, got involved. This is the National Year of Disabled Persons. Is this the year you get involved? Call the office of your mayor or county commissioner for more information.
This has been ABC News Nightline. To obtain a transcript of tonight's broadcast, send $2 to Nightline, Box 234, Ansonia Station, New York, New York, 10023. Presentation of ABC News.